Okay, this is the University of Islam, Los Angeles. I was the minister of this mosque in Los Angeles, where we had a University of Islam. You see our children. We had our own school. We had approximately 500 boys and girls going to this school. This is what the dress like, the motor dress. Under the guidance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he teaches us that we must prepare our children at a young and early age because they are the future rulers of the earth. And being the future rulers of the earth, we are taught that they must prepare themselves. You see our young men, the way they dress, the way they look like young businessmen. Everybody got their briefcases. They're taking care of business. Sister Clara Muhammad, the first lady, wife of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The lost found. This is one of our farms in Michigan. This is some of the land that we acquired under the leadership and guidance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You see the used silos there, food bins for the cattle. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad was given a special ingredient to go in the food by Almighty God Allah, that the cattle were the most fertile cattle in the world. This is inside of one of the storehouses for the equipment. Everything. At that time, I was an amateur photographer when I took this, so don't expect to see it like you would if you were watching MGM or something. But anyway, I did the best I could at the time because I just had a new camera and I was breaking it in, and the messenger had sent me out to do the film not only there in Michigan but in the San Joaquin Valley. Our farms, we had millions of acres of land. This is what we had acquired. We acquired this land through the, this is some chickens. We'll get back to that later, but this is just a brief sketch of the chickens that was being prepared for the mosque. Just, this is back on the farm. This shows you some of the corn that was being planted, fresh and crop, the storage tanks, the gasoline and all that. And this farm in Michigan, this one farm here, had thousands of acres on it. This is just one part of it. The corn that you see there, a couple of months up out of the ground, weeks. This is some of the farm equipment here. See, these huge bins had just cars, trucks, and all tractors, farm equipment, that house these. This is in the dairy. We'll get back to this dairy later, but this was one of the most modern dairies. In this dairy, the milk was not pasteurized like they do, like the white man pasteurized his milk. We had our milk, we had people coming out to our farm, white people and everybody trying to get some of this milk because this was the most purest milk. These are some more food bins for the cattle. The food is mixed. This is one of our trucks from Chicago, which came over to the Michigan farm to pick up some eggs and meat and milk. You will probably see them loading up the truck with milk in a minute to carry to the Salam restaurant, and they're putting the milk in there. And this is one of the farmhouses. All the farmhouses were mostly two stories. They were modern. Everything in it was up to modern. Young Black Woman didn't want our people to have to work on farms and have insufficient machinery, housing, equipment, everything, all the washing machines, everything was modern. So the people lived good. We made them convenient out there. These are the brothers loading up eggs. You see our sister here, she ran the egg factory there. These are the chickens. These chickens laid eggs around the clock. You see, none of them touched the ground. We didn't allow chickens to touch the ground. Neither were the chickens able to eat the waste like others. These bins were cleaned on an hourly basis. Brothers would come in and clean all the waste of the chickens, and they continue to eat and lay eggs all day long, night. We're going to another part of the farm right now, vegetable farm, where the brothers have spring beans. They load up cabbage, lettuce, and these apples in those crates out there. They're going to the supermarket. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that we must be producers as well as consumers. So he was making it possible so we could eat the best of food produced by us. We did not, none of these crops had any type of additive to the fertilizer or anything. We didn't use DDT or anything. Everything was bug free. We used the natural elements of the earth to raise our food. You see the brothers irrigating this. Now getting ready, this food will be ready, as he told me, in about 4 to 6 weeks for the market where he just planted. This is the fruit farm. Apples, the most delicious apples you want to eat. The brothers up there picking some apples there. And as I watched him, I decided I wanted to pick some too. So you see me up there. I had to get in on that. So I feel like picking your own. Picking something that belongs to you. Going to the market. So we're back at another part of the farm now. This is another farmhouse that we are at. And you see they're all two-story. All these farmhouses are two-story. So the people lived good. They had television, everything, even the tractors. They had stereos on them so the brothers could just ride the tractors and go over the land, cultivate the land, listen to the music as they some of them had even air conditioning on the tractors. This is another one of the silos at another part of our farm. All that land, as far as you can see, in any direction belong to the Nation of Islam. We had bombs in Georgia. We had cannon factories that were set up on all the farms where we can our food fresh, right from the field. And brothers would volunteer and go out in the farms to get away from the city life, to go out to spend a weekend or a day just working on the farm. This brother is getting ready to milk the cows. You will see some of the most contented cows that has ever been. These cows don't have to be told or guided in anything. These cows come in. They stand right there at that door and won't move until time that brother right there, when he moves, the cows are moving. Each one will go to their own stall. Nobody's showing them which way to go or what. You see each cow going to their own stall to be milked. And these cows are clean. You're not dirty and filthy. You look at the legs and things, you don't see nothing. Look at the milk bags. These cows need 8 to 10 gallons and sometimes 15 gallons apiece every milk. You can tell how these cows, well, that cow there stopped right at the door. I want to show you this. I'm going to back it up a minute here. See, this cow right here, see, the other cows were going in. And this cow, it knew when the stalls were full. There was nobody telling it to stop. Nobody there. And then when the stalls get empty, they go out on the other end, and these other cows start coming right on in. Look at the back of their legs and everything. You see no waste or nothing in there. The floors are spotless. People will come from all over Illinois to our dairy to get this milk because it wasn't like the milk that you got in the store. There's the milk coming into the containers, and after it goes into the containers, then it is pumped into a big vat. And from that vat, then it is put in a stainless steel can, and then it is bottled. Now that was the first milk. You see how much milk is in those. Now the cows are going out the back way. And the other cows, when they get out, the other cows will come in. And they will be milked. We had our own beef cows, cows that were just for milk, beef. And these cows were just for milk. This is a steel vat that the milk is pumped into. And we're back in Chicago now. This is the Your Supermarket in Chicago. I'm pressing over the Salam restaurant. And we inside, that was the bakery that was in then. This is the dress factory where our uniforms and the dresses, the sisters' dresses and uniforms are made. Minister in San Diego, California. And these are the sisters hard at work making the uniforms. We also had a uniform factory in Los Angeles, one in New York. See, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is telling us we must be producers as well as consumers. We don't need someone else making our clothes for us to wear when we can make them ourselves. Brother, he's getting ready to cut the material. And he usually cut 50 to 60 pieces at a time. Now we're back inside of the supermarket. And I was taking the picture on the mirror up on the wall, reflecting back on the food and everything, because I didn't have a high enough position where I could shoot with the mirror and reflected all of it. And it was hard to keep the market stocked. People would come all over Chicago just to our market because they knew that they had the best of food. These are some of our watermelons that came off the farm. Now we're getting ready for our first annual parade. This parade is the first time the Muslims ever came public showing their strength. We had thousands of brothers dressed in uniform and sisters. We took over the whole south side of Chicago. We relieved the police force of the whole south side. We didn't want them anywhere on the south side because we didn't want any incident. And we showed everyone that we were capable of handling our people and the south side of Chicago ourselves without anyone from the outside. This is inside the Salam restaurant. And, a couple of brothers, this brother in the white suit, he was the one that helped me start the mosque in Los Angeles. And the other brother that was sitting there, he was one of the members of the Midnighters. I don't know if you know about the Midnighters. And but he even quit the Midnighters. He came to Los Angeles and we got in a session. And so he let the Midnighters go on their tour and he stayed there. Because I had the privilege of teaching a lot of people. A lot of people that you see that in the movies and things now. The brother there in the blue over there, that was Leonard Weir. He was one of the brothers that started the first policeman, black police unity, and it shook up the country. White policemen always had organizations within the police force, but they didn't want black to have any. So when this brother decided to do this, they wanted to dismiss him from the police force, so he filed suit. He wanted to unite the black policemen so they could protect black people instead of joining the white people and beating them and killing them. Here you see some of the brothers. This is just a small portion of the ones See, the people had never seen this many black people in uniform in America before that wasn't part of the United States of America's Army or Navy or Marines or Air Force. See, when they saw these brothers, they saw a nation that they wasn't able to control. They saw all these black men in uniform that scared everybody. They had helicopters flying all over the air watching police helicopters and everybody. But it shook them up. These were balloons and things the brothers were getting ready to prepare for the sisters. You see, these are some of the brothers that didn't have uniforms. They were dressed in suits and ties. You see them sitting down over there. You see all these brothers. This is beautiful when you see black people come together in unity. These brothers ready to fight and die in a minute for the black man and woman in America. Nobody dared do anything when they saw all this. They knew the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wasn't playing when they saw this. This is Allah's army. You used to sing in church, I'm in the army for my Lord. I'm in the army for my Lord. But we are in the army for our Lord. This Minister Philbert, he was Malcolm's brother. The one was in the suit there. He's the one that brought Malcolm into the nation. Not right now. Not right now. That's me and a couple of my ministers from the West Coast. These are some of the sisters that were in the tent. Now these are real soldiers. We soldiered for that devil and fought and died for him. Now you see brothers soldiering for the nation of Islam, ready to fight and die for self. There you see most sisters get beautiful and beautiful all the time. It's not in the tent in the Arabian desert. In the Sudan or somewhere. This is right here in America. All these beautiful sisters under the tent. This is the way the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wanted to see all of us. When you got sisters looking that beautiful, you're ready to die for them. And if you're not ready to die for them, then you'll die for not being ready to die. Because we didn't have no brothers that wasn't ready to stand up and give their life for them. Brothers, they just kept coming. See, we had companies of brothers. The majority of the brothers had been placed on a 6-mile stretch from 89th Street to on the south side of Chicago to 46th Street. We had had them on in between.
Good to see brothers. Stand fight for the nation of Islam. Brother Williams there, one of the directors of the school in Los Angeles.
This is some of the ministers right there on the top row. There's Minister Farrakhan right there. You see him right there in the dark glasses. That's our moon and star. And this day, they said it was going to rain and storm us out. But it cleared up. And the sun gave a divine revelation. It flashed on the moon and star. So we lined the police up and retired them. They came out and wanted to help. We told them we didn't need them. Parked the cars and sit there and look. This is our day. They had that. And they did. And the mayor of Chicago got on the radio and television that night and said he wanted to commend the Honorable Elijah Muhammad for the work that he has done, that not one incident was reported to the police force on the whole south side of Chicago during the day that we had our parade. No robberies, no murders, no thefts, nothing. Because this shook up everybody. Everybody was out to see what we were doing. They had never seen nothing like this before. Everybody stopped doing everything they were doing and came out to our parade. The clown band. Car couldn't go on its own powder, so we had to put some black powder behind it. Move it on out the wheel. See the helicopters up there? They were flying all day long up there in there. We had them all over the south side, just flying up there. Looking to see what we were doing. They didn't know what was going to happen. But we had everything under control. See all our beautiful sisters over there? They were lined up like that for 6 miles. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad wasn't playing no game. He was serious. And we were serious. For the first time in our life, we had a leader and teacher that was doing something for us. And we were letting the world know how proud we were of him. This is why we don't have any juvenile problems, because they can see, our children can see a future. You can't see a future in Christianity. The children don't see anything. You will see some of the beautiful buildings. You see one of the most modern printing presses in the world that we bought. One of the floats. The brother said, well, the devil's flag didn't fly. I was just doing everything. That flag was hanging there almost. The wind wouldn't even blow it out. This is the junior MGT, the Young Sisters, the Nation of Islam. Muslim girls train them from an early age how to be queens. Now, men ought to be kings. We're the future rulers of the planet Earth. And since Almighty God has chosen us to inherit the earth, then we want to be qualified for that which we are about to receive. This quote depicts our Muslim farms. Buses showing that the Nation of Islam was teaching their own. We had our own universities of Islam where we taught our own children. We didn't have to send them to the white people's schools or have white teachers teaching them. The Sabah's bakeries, it was in our bakeries, one of the trucks representing our farms. And we had brothers like that every 20 feet for 6 miles. You see these brothers touring every 20 feet like that for 6 miles. That was one of my free school tenants. The parade started at the Salam restaurant, and it ended up at the messenger's house. Children, they wanted to get in on it too. They said, this belonged to me too. And these are some of the brothers that was outside of the messenger's house. They were getting ready to drill for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But the devil was there too. the brother and sister that was getting off then, those, they got married that day. Minister James Shabazz, a brother was with the messenger for a long time. There's the Honorable Elijah Muhammad back in the doorway. That's his son Nathaniel that stepped out in front of him. And that was the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is saluting back there. He's in uniform. You see him in the uniform. This the guy on the left there, he's from Pakistan. Sister Clara Muhammad right beside the messenger. But the ambassador for Pakistan was there to offer support in case we needed. This is in slow motion, but my brother is drilling now. Crack here for life. His brothers. And we back at the Salam restaurant in the tent. This is the dinner that day. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad fed 10,000 people from our farm. Free, and you should have seen the people coming. Boy, people were walking away beside the lamb. I mean, it was grabbing. You didn't, you know, you wouldn't think people would. They think they would get them a sandwich or dinner and everything. Man, they were just coming and grabbing. We had this supervisor stop. We had plenty of food. Food was just everywhere. And this was inside the restaurant. This was our most delicious, but we had all outside other than the tents and everything for the people of Chicago and those who came. And he paid 10,000 free in charge of people. This is one of our jazz bands. Sorry you're not able to see. It's clear that it does. The lighting, I have a strobe on my camera. But you can imagine what it was like. Muslims dining, enjoying themselves. This is back in Los Angeles at the mosque that I was the minister over. See what the sisters look like. We had balconies, we had upstairs, downstairs, it was full. It was always full. I would like to have a mosque that full here. But we had thousands of brothers and sisters. And we started from nothing. Good. And there's yours truly. Look a little dark, you can't see me, but I'm black and I'm proud. Now we're back in Chicago at the Muhammad Speaks newspaper. This was one of the most modern printing presses in the world. There was only one of its kind in America. And Sweden sent it over here as a display so the American presses could see it, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad bought the display. They had a tour of all the publishers, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad bought the whole plant, the display. He said he didn't want nobody else in it no more but black people. And he bought it. And we started our people. This is a tour through the Muhammad Speaks newspaper, these offices. Writing desks. Layouts. This is one of the executive conference rooms. This is inside another executive office. And this is the Supreme Captain's office at the Muhammad Speaks newspaper office. These are the layout rooms. These are the brothers getting ready to lay out. Most of you brothers and sisters have read and saw captions of the comics and strips and things in the Muhammad Speaks. This brother that did it, brother Majid. This brother was great in his caption. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad would tell him something that he wanted, and he would do it. That was the brother. These are some of the new machines that we had just recently purchased. Minutes you'll see the meat packing house, slaughterhouse. Another part of the layout room and everything where they get it ready. Writers. This is the photographer layout. I think we had the only printing press in the country that did multi colors on every page. This is the press. It's a huge thing. It's about a block long. Covers the whole distance of the building, and the building covers almost approximately a whole city block. So it's almost as long as the building. We had to buy our own timber. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad bought land so we could use our own timber because the white men didn't want to sell us paper. So we had to start our own paper mill and everything. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said we don't need them to do nothing. When we bought this press, there was nobody that knew how to use it. So the Swiss people told us that they would give us instructors for 2 months. And the messenger told them that we won't need them that long. He said, just begin to give us the basis of how to operate it, and we'll do it ourselves. So in 3 weeks, he dismissed all the Swiss and let them go back to Sweden. We were running the press by ourselves. And there you can see the paper lined up, getting ready to start rolling. You can see multicolors on it. It's getting put out. This is how you get recognition, being independent. You can't be equal or respected as an equal when you got to depend on everybody else for everything that you get. You got to depend on the white man for food, clothing, and shelter. He don't respect you. This is our plan. This is inside of the slaughterhouse. This is where they cut and process the meat and get ready for shipping it. The meat is processed in a manner cattle are not slaughtered. There's any old way they're slaughtered where all the blood is drained out of them. And the food, when you eat the meat, it's so sweet and tender, you will be surprised when you eat taste like that. Brothers processing the eggs. When the eggs come from the farm, they put them in here and put them on the machines and they spec them. And they remove all the bad eggs. They go through the light and they check them out. The brother's taking them off. You see them down the line. It's bad when they take it out of there. He watches. Now we come into the mosque that the messenger purchase on Stony Island. At this time, it belonged to the Greek Orthodox. First, they only wanted $1.5 million for it. The messenger put up $1 million, put it in escrow, and they changed and said they didn't want to sell it. And then they came up with and the pennies and nickels and dimes that were coming off of those papers were what was buying these things. This is the Orthodox temple. In a few minutes, you'll see the cross up on top of it that's made out of pure gold. After he went up to 6 million, the messenger told him that they couldn't remove anything from it. The inside was gold. Everything, the stairwell was lined with gold.
gold was all over the place. So he told them that they couldn't remove anything out of it. They just had to walk out. Now that cross up there, as large as it is, it's made out of solid gold. The messenger said, we'll melt it down and put a crescent in this place. That's what he did. He melted that gold down. This is the devil hanging up there. Who's that gold? This is where the University of Islam is. Number two in Chicago. This is the hospital down the street, two blocks down the street, that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wanted to buy for the nation. So we would have our own doctors. We wouldn't have to go to the white hospital, depending on them. The devil diagnosing us wrong, cutting us up just because we're guinea pigs. This is another part, angle from mosque. It took up a whole city square block. From 73rd to 74th Street. And this is a playground across from it. We bought that too. So the children would have a place to play in. This is the inside of it. I wasn't able to get good shots. The gold was lined all up in the top of it. All up in there was gold. Handrails as you walk down the aisles of gold. This is a beautiful place now. This is one of our farms. California. This is the brother and his wife who were managing. That was the backyard garden. Look in the distance, you were looking all on the same farm, all in all directions. This is something that instilled pride and dignity into us. It made us feel that we are people who were told we could never accomplish anything, prove to the world what could be done overnight if we united together. And this is what unity can do. You see, we're not uniting, marching down the streets to integrate with white people. We're uniting to build something for ourselves and our children, so they'll have a future. During the summer, we let our children go out on the farms, enjoy themselves.
ride horses, work. All this land, when the white people saw that we wanted to do something, then they were eager to sell us anything we wanted, although they charged us more than it was worth. But we needed it in order to show our people what we could do if we united together and become an independent people. And this is how we got the respect. You have to respect the people that are producers. This is the irrigation going to not only the corn and the other vegetation out there, but it's also going to the trees. We have olive, almond trees, almond arches. We had grape arches. Arches, as far as you can see, the grapes. We're just riding over the land now, look at it. See, this is the man that you see, these are almonds. These, yeah, that was the almond orchard. This is cotton. We had our own cotton picking machine. Not to worry about people going out there. Brothers sitting on those tractors, doing all that. Acres and acres and acres. It took me a whole day, about 7 in the morning, to go over all of the, take these pictures of all the land. And I still didn't get all of it. And that's what, just at one place, in the San Joaquin Valley, in Los Angeles, in California, off of Fresno. Get in your car and you ride today and you see all this land all up and down the highway and white people on it all. We don't have nothing. And yet still we want to be called equals. All that beautiful corn across over there. We get out and stalks with this bull. This is the grapes. Big bunches. Grapes. Honolulu. Brown's a great farm. He's a big tree. Bushes look like trees, as far as you can see. That's the devil that's driving there. He's the one that we bought this land from. He's showing you the grapes there. He's putting out bunches there. I don't know if you can see it. Then all those are new grapevines that's been planted. All those fields out there are new. Far as you can see. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad knew what he was doing. He was not only a spiritual teacher, he was everything. He was everything that people need. These were newly planted. This is another field that was just newly planted with grapevines. These are some of the cattle. Beef. There's another part of the farm with grapes. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad wanted to supply us with everything that we need, not short us of anything. You see, our nation needs everything. He wanted everything the white man had, and more. These are sheep. This is a sheep farm. We produce some of the best lamb chops. Trees. Those are olives. I mean, not olive, almond trees. Everything well taken care of. You don't see no grass growing up or anything. And everything is well taken. That's about it, brothers and sisters. I have more film, but I don't have them with me that I could show you. Some other